IVM. Storytel is an audiobook platform that lets you hear hundreds of thousands of stories on your mobile, PC, wherever you prefer. This week, I'm going to recommend a modern classic. It's a story that many have seen, but few have heard or read. Game of Thrones by George R.R. Martin. The story is loosely based on the War of the Roses succession fights in 15th century England. When you hear Roy Dotrice narrate the story, it really brings it alive. Go to storytel.com/IVM and you'll be able to get your first month for 99 rupees. That's 200 rupees off the regular 299 a month price. That's storytel.com/IVM. Go get it now.
26th of July 2005, if you remember the year. This was the first big flood in Bombay.
Oh, yes, of course.
This was my first day in Bombay.
You landed on that day.
That was the day of my interview in Bombay. I think a career shift and a professional shift was the least of my problems. My memory of the first day in Bombay was walking in about deep water, right? Above my waist. And I'm like, this is a new city. I'm here for a job. I don't know what I'm doing. But there was a lovely energy to it. I kind of fell in love with Bombay on that day. Because with all of that was happening and people were walking in water, houses were flooded, there was a massive smile on everyone's face.
Hello and welcome to the Filter Coffee Podcast. When I was in school, I practically grew up on stories of mythology. Indian, Greek, Chinese, and so many more. I found them more fun and enriching than anything else, any other fiction I could lay my hands on those days. There was a sense of magic to it, just like there was with superheroes. Indian mythology especially seemed to have an astonishing range of stories, from the moral to the magical to sometimes even the mundane. Decades later, today, at times when I want to go back to those stories, I feel my options are very restricted. We still seem to be going back to the same Amarchitra Kathas and other books that I read in the 90s. And if I want to switch to video animation in the form of television or movies, well, the least said, the better. For a country which thrives on storytelling in various forms, I don't know why we cannot do better than Chota Bhim or Baal Hanuman. And where is the mature fiction for adults? Why can't we go beyond the handful of main protagonists in the Mahabharata or the Ramayana into the universe of subplots there? These are questions I was, battling in my mind. And that is when I discovered this treasure trove called Vanarasena Studios, who are creating some great art and stories for adults, which are based on extraordinary characters from the Indian mythology. Except they stay away from the word mythology itself. For my guest today, Vivek Ram, Senapati of Vanarasena Studios, which is what his official title is. These are just stories. And when we use the word mythology, we seem to subconsciously add more religious subtexts to it than necessary. Vivek has had a prolific career in the world of animation, especially in Hollywood. He has been a part of films like Superman Returns, Fast and the Furious, and The Incredible Hulk. He has also been a part of the Academy Award-winning team that did the VFX for The Golden Compass. Vanarasena Studios is his movement for elevating the storytelling game of quintessentially Indian stories, which the rest of us would call mythological, and ensure that it is accessible to generations of Indians on social platforms, OTT channels, and in multiple other form factors. I want to talk to him about his journey so far, his vision for storytelling itself, and the exciting plans he has for the global Indian audience. Welcome to the Filter Coffee Podcast, Vivek. How are you doing?
Thank you, Karthik. I'm doing good. How are you?
Not bad at all, man. This is a conversation I've been wanting to have ever since we first spoke, because I don't think I've ever touched the subject of art and mythology in this series up until now. But I'm getting ahead of the story here. You were always fascinated by animation, right? And what I understand is that's how you began your career. Is it correct?
Yes. Since 96 now. Like when I was in college, just before entering college, I've been fascinated with art. I've been fascinated since I was a kid. I've been drawing since forever, or at least trying to draw. Now when I look at those, then I was not drawing. But at least back then I thought I was drawing. So I was always fascinated with the idea, and animation just became a very natural segue for what I do. And like, it's, I think since 96 onwards, I've been kind of dabbling with this, and I haven't gotten bored yet. So I think that's a good sign.
but what was the dream in mid-90s? Where were you going with it back then?
So I had no idea, right? I started off, I was in Pune. We bought a new computer and someone said, hey, there's a new software that you can try out. And I just started trying out this software. And then for the first, and you know what internet was like in 96, right? Dial-up connections and YouTube wasn't there and you didn't have any resources. So you just had a software clicking buttons around. And I, for the next 4 to 5 years, I didn't know you could make a career out of it. It was hobby. I got into engineering. I was doing electronics and telecom engineering. I flunked a year. And then I realized there was, my heart was just not into engineering. And I was sitting and drawing in the last bench, right? So this seemed like something I really liked to do. I didn't know what I could do with it. So, but I think around 2000, around 99, 2000 is when people started saying, hey, can you make this little poster for us? Can you do this little graphic for us? Can you try some kind of a little video? And that's when I'm like, hey, shit, I can make some money out of this. So that was interesting. And then, of course, that's when I started looking more consciously for how I can make this a profession, make this something that I can earn from and do this 24/7. I think, yeah, that kind of took me down this road. I ended up quitting college. I didn't graduate. I dropped out and I'm like, this is what I want to do.
And that did take you places, right? You worked with Hollywood studios. Right. You've been part of some of the biggest films of our times. Talk to us a little bit more about how all those things happened.
Okay. So initially for the first few years, I was freelancing. I was doing these small little gigs. Then of course, internet got better. I think we had broadband for the first time in India, and we could actually kind of connect to clients and things abroad. So I started doing some, like, I was in gaming and I was doing some asset building for games and some designs and stuff. And this is all broadband. And at that point, even then, in India, I didn't know that there were existing companies. There were a few existing companies, all of them were new, but there was no way of finding these things out, right? Even figuring out how to use the internet was taking time for a lot of people. So ultimately, I ended up finding this company called Rhythm & Hues in Bombay. And Rhythm & Hues had been in Bombay for already some 5 years. No, sorry, 3 years or so. And I just heard about them and I saw the kind of work they were doing. Then I kind of backtracked on their history and it turned out to be this 15-year-old company back then in LA. And they had done some of the pioneering work in Hollywood. They had won an Oscar for Babe at that point. And a lot of stuff had happened. And so I wrote to them. I was like, will I get a job here? And I'm not a graduate. I'm thinking of dropping out of college. And I showed them whatever work that I'd done. I was, thankfully, they called me in. We did a test and I cleared the test and I joined the signed up there. That kind of, I would say, was like the real launch of this being a career for me. Because from there, then I did a couple of movies. I worked on Fast and the Furious Tokyo Drift and Superman Returns, Incredible Hulk, Golden Compass, a whole bunch of films. And I think there was another high there when Golden Compass won the Oscars. So I was part of the Oscar team. I was 26 and I was part of an Oscar team. And I was like super, super proud. So by the time I left Rhythm & Hues, I think I'd touched about 11 to 12 Hollywood films.
Wow.
And then DreamWorks called and DreamWorks was setting up in India for the first time. So they were looking at some of the best talent around in different studios. They called, I joined DreamWorks. I worked on a couple of their DVD films. Then I left DreamWorks. I did some freelancing for a while. Then DreamWorks called back again. So then I went back to DreamWorks for another 5 year stint. And there I worked on like Madagascar 3 and Penguins of Madagascar, all of that. And then I quit DreamWorks again. That's kind of a cycle in my life.
but you know, for a boy in Pune who's trying to monetize his art, so to say, and then you write to this big organization and then you're going in there. What was the change? Like, you know, how were they doing it? And was it inspiring for you? What was the shift?
If you ask me about a shift, it was way too many things. I'll tell you what day I came to Bombay. It was 26th of July 2015, if you remember the... Sorry, 2005, if you remember the year. This was the first big flood in Bombay.
Oh, yes, of course.
This was my first day in Bombay.
You landed on that day.
That was the day of my interview in Bombay. With my portfolio, I landed on that day in Bombay. I think a career shift and a professional shift was the least of my problems. Like the first day in Bombay, my memory of the first day in Bombay was walking in about deep water, right? Above my waist. And I'm like, this is a new city. I'm here for a job. I don't know what I'm doing. But there was a lovely energy to it. Like there was a lovely... I kind of fell in love with Bombay on that day because with all of that that was happening and people were walking in water, houses were flooded. There was a massive smile on everyone's face, right? They were just like, yeah, we'll get through this also. So I think that prepped me for whatever was to come. So moving from Pune to finding a house in Bombay, finding this little apartment and then finding this job and then trying to fit into this. So I would say that from that day on, it was just about let's take it all on with a smile. Like it kind of became that mantra, right? So for me, Rhythm and News, if you ask me what were the difficulties, I don't remember, honestly.
But from a craft perspective, right? Like when you're doing this on your own, you're figuring things out, etc., right? And then you suddenly jump onto a Hollywood scale animation studio, then the process itself is very different. Scale, of course, is very different.
Scale is different, yeah. Process is different, but that was the primary reason I joined Rhythm and News, because I was looking at it not as something where I'm working in a Hollywood film. I was looking at it more as I have a ton to learn. So this was Rhythm and News more than a studio was a massive library for me. So my goal was very clear. I was like, okay, I have to finish my work. I have to do whatever they need me to do. But my goal was that I have to soak in as much information as I can. This was my goal. So I don't think at any point I was looking at it as getting into a bigger league. I was like, this bigger league is now going to funnel and like source, what do you say, right? Energize me to another level. So I was very clear about that. Rhythm and News office was very, very work friendly, very employee friendly. They would ask people to kind of leave at 5 o'clock in the evening, go home, have a life. I stayed over at office. I would sleep on the beanbag in the office because this was my moment to soak in all that knowledge. So I would sit and learn because they opened up. There was a clear open network between LA and India. So you could source any of the files you wanted for the last 10 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So you could just open up the file, see what's going on, see how they did it, see how they managed it. And I think I was just hungry for knowledge at that point. So for me, that question is very different. I don't think I get intimidated easily. I'm usually trying to soak up as much as I can. So yeah, it is a very different thing.
But, for films like the ones you mentioned, right, where Fast and Furious or Madagascar, etc., what part of the work, do you get to do out of India and how collaborative is it with the core team in Hollywood? Can you just give us an example of how this works?
Initially, when any company sets up in India, whether it's Rhythm and News or DreamWorks or any of these companies, there's a slight bit of a testing ground where they're not sure how much we can handle, not because we lack the skill, but because we lack the exposure. Like, for example, you have a film like Golden Compass, where the ending scene is all snow. How many Indians have seen snow, right? It's just so new for us as an idea. Or if they say, something, we used to make fun of this thing about how we say, let's take a parcel and they say to go, right? And it's such a different terminology. So when they speak to us itself, there's a lot of miscommunication initially until they learn our way, we learn their way, and we all understand what communication is like. So any studio, whether it's DreamWorks or Rhythm and News, for the first year or so is testing out quality, whether they can get to a certain quality bar, whether the people can kind of do that kind of work, the temperament of the people, this side and that. Right? Whether the person that they think is a rock star artist in LA can be a supervisor for India. Like, does he understand that? Whether a rock star artist in India can communicate back to his supervisors in India. Whether you can have supervisors in India in the first place. Right? All of these things take time. They take time in the sense of they take years. So 2-3 years at times. So like I know when DreamWorks set up, the first feature film that happened in India was, I think, 3 years down the line. They did a lot of DVD stuff and all that. And then 3 years down the line, they started sending feature film work. And by the time I...
What do you mean when you say DVD stuff?
Like there are films that go direct to DVD.
Ah, okay.
They don't have theatrical release.
Right.
So, and films that go direct to like a channel, but they don't like a Christmas special, but they don't have a theatrical release. So the quality level on that is a bit lower than what you would put into a feature film. So that's how they kind of build you up to that feature film level. And so by the time they kind of start doing feature film work, they start with certain departments. So they start with this department can handle it, then another department, but it won't go full force initially. It won't be like, here's a film, do it in India. That doesn't happen, right? That happens over a period of time. So like Penguins of Madagascar, for example, was the like around 80% of the production was India. So we did the modeling, animation, texturing, like all of it, right? Around 80% of it was done in India. But if you look at Madagascar 3, about 30% was done in India. So it's like, it's different stages, different projects. So when they give you the work, there is every day there's communication, right? There's morning calls, evening calls, and you're constantly checking if the work is happening the way everyone wants it to happen. And it's not one-way traffic. It's collaborative. You tell them what can be better. They tell you what can be better. We are all discussing the project at that point. So if you work for an outsourced studio in India, then they tell you what they want, what their requirements are, and you execute. Whereas if you're a studio like Rhythm & News or Double Negative or DreamWorks that is in India, then you collaborate. So then it's not an outsourced project anymore. They tell you something, you tell them what can be better, and you kind of go back and forth. You tell them sometimes it can't be done within that time and they understand it. So it's almost like one studio. Especially with Rhythm & News, the network is a single network. So at any point, anyone in LA and anyone in India can look at each other's work, can talk to each other over a chat, all of that, or get on a call on your desk. So it just feels like one studio at that point.
Oh, wow.
And what they also do with, like when we were in DreamWorks, they did that a lot more. They send people from India to the US and they send people from US to India so that you know the people. You sit and have a coffee with them or you sit and have a drink with them. So you get to kind of interact with them a little better.
Right.
Yeah.
How was the Oscar moment?
Oscar moment was amazing and unfortunate for me. We won the Oscars. I knew we won the Oscars. So I knew my name is on the film. So I was part of the Oscar team. And then I moved to DreamWorks when the statue came to India. So I didn't get my moment with the statue, but I had moved to DreamWorks by then.
Okay.
Well, it was good. At that point, it was a high because I've been in an Oscar team. That is the best thing you could do as a team player. And then I'm like, okay, now time to move on to see what more I can do with my career.
Right. So I want to, at this point, quickly shift, and we'll come back to animation in a bit. I want to shift to this other dimension, you know, to your career itself, which I'm very curious to understand. What does mythology mean to you? And where did it start?
For starters, I never use the word mythology, right? It's a term that I don't use because I feel like in today's context, it gets lost in translation. It sparks things more than anything else, right? When you use that word as mythology. I also don't use the word history because again, that has its own connotations. I look at it purely as stories. So for me, my entire, whether I look at actually what you would call mythology or history, I look at them as stories. It helps me make it very clear what the intent is. So moving forward, that's why we have episodes called Ancient Indian Stories. We don't say mythology, we don't say history, we say none of that. At the end of the day, like, it's the question I ask a lot of people who talk to us, that do you think this was history? I'm like, okay, let's assume it was history. Now what are you going to do with it? Right? Like, what does that information mean to you? Nothing. Your day goes on. And if I say, okay, it's not history, again, what does that information do to you? Nothing. It's like two dogs barking on either side of the gate, right? You open the gate up and suddenly you're like, okay, shit, I don't want to fight. So we just keep it as stories so that it's just clear. It's stories.
It's a label that has absolutely zero consequence to your life.
Correct. Like, even if I look at World War II and Hitler, I'm like, okay, I can look at it as history, or I can just look at it as a story, and that has more value to me as a story. Because then I understand that something like this happened and what I can take out of it. Rather than, okay, it happened, yes, I'll fight for the fact that it happened. It's pointless. So we call it stories. And that interest for me started in childhood. Grew up in a proper conservative household, traditional household. We went to temple every week, maybe twice a week, thrice a week, even when we were in Dubai. So I was born in Dubai. But even while we were in Dubai, it's like we still found the temples, right? We still found ways to kind of continue with that tradition. We had our festivals that were celebrated among close communities. Back then, my uncle would keep couriering Amar Chitra Katha, Panchatantra, all of these things to us in Dubai until we moved to India. And then India, of course, there was an overload of all of this information. So my curiosity started with, I love the stories. I love the characters. They're your introduction to fascinating magic and fantasy, right? Then I started going to temples, and my fascination in temples was less prayer and more wall paintings and statues and murals, and looking at them and saying, who's that character? What did he do? Who's this character with the big teeth? What did he do? And what are the stories? So for me, the stories have always fascinated me. Over a period of time, I think even in the 10th standard, we were supposed to do history, like a history project. And everyone picked different, like, freedom movement and this and that and all. And I went straight to the Vedas. I said, this is where I want to do my research and on my project. And fortunately or unfortunately, I was bombarded with a ton of information. I started reading the Vedas. I started reading the Upanishads. I started reading the Puranas, the multiple details, the various forms, different libraries. And I was like, this is way more than what our traditional conservative households tell us. Right? There's a lot more value to it. There's a lot more knowledge to it. And then it's just snowballed from there, I would say, from that point on. And so, which is also why I kept quitting companies and moving through different things, because I was never satisfied with what I was doing there. I was happy, but I was not satisfied because the Indian stories would stick in my head. So even when I was working with Rhythm and News, there are some artworks that are out there where I would go to office, come back home, and then do a painting of Ram or a painting of Hanuman or an imagination of what those characters could look like. So my heart was still there, always. And like I'm a huge fan of the Ramayana. Like Ramayana is my best book ever, tips.
Why?
Because firstly, oldest epic, oldest, largest epic of that volume. But okay, that's pointless. Secondly, it's a love story. It's the world's first love story, right? It's about a man who went all the way walking for about, you know, about 1,500 kilometers because someone took his wife away, right? And he was willing to do this alone. He didn't ask for help, which is also why we are called Vanarsena. And we talk about this in some other talks also, where the Vanarsena is the first voluntary organization, right? Because Ram said, can you help me find my wife? They went and found his wife. And then he said, like, okay, thank you. I'm going to war. Whereas the Vanarsena was like, no, we'll come help you. So they said, we'll help you. He was willing to go fight that war on his own. He was willing to take on all those people because he was in love with his wife. And the Vanarsena decided, no, we'll come and help you. We'll come and join forces. We will fight Ravan with you. And so you have a love story and a voluntary organization. Like for me, it's fascinating with warfare, romance, fantasy, all of that. There's a great villain in Ravan, right? Who's powerful, majestic, who's like unbeaten until this fellow came across, right? To come there. And he's loved by his people. He's a fantastic musician, but has a lust problem. Like he's horny. Now, so that's what brings about his downfall. So you have such beautiful characters, and then you have this, so you have an all built inside a love story. Like, what do you want? What more do you want, right? It's the perfect masala for a story. So which is a plus lots of philosophies of life, like fascinating philosophies of life, of what cause and effect is, and the choices you make, and what civilization could mean if you choose to. Like, we even spoke about this on one of the recent videos that we wanted to do. But what does Ram mean? And for me, they say Maryada Purushottam, and the whole world is talking about how Ram is a great ideal example. And I'm like, no, he's not, right? Ram is a fantastic example of a leader. Not about you and me, right? Unless you and me are leading people, Ram is not an example for us. But Ram is a fantastic example for our politicians, for our leaders, about selfless activity, about how the nation or the people that you rule over are bigger than you, how your likes and dislikes are not primary. And that's what Ram stands for, right? And that's what Sita stands for. And that's why, like, Ram and Sita are equals in the Valmiki Ramayana. Ram and Sita are constantly arguing, constantly debating, and Sita always wins. And because she is well-versed in statescraft more than Ram is. Of course, in the later retelling, Sita kind of gets sidelined and pushed and all of that. But yeah, it's the first one is fascinating in all of these aspects because Sita and Ram understand governance. They understand that they are not bigger than the people.
Hey, can you give me an example of that from a statecraft perspective?
So when Ram was sent to exile, Ram was the crown prince. Ram was supposed to be crowned the king. Ram had three brothers, right? This we all know. Yeah. When Dashrath sends him to exile, when Dashrath says, okay, my son, you have to go to exile because I screwed up. I gave a promise that I have to kind of uphold. Ram's argument to Dashrath is, if the king does not uphold his, not argument, sorry, for then Dashrath says, you know what, forget what I said. You stay. I'll figure this out. And Ram says, no, if the king does not uphold his word, then who will? Right? So the king has to uphold his word, no matter what the consequence. Then Lakshman comes to Ram and says that, let's just jail our father. And this is usually kept out of the later retellings. But in the Valmiki Ramayana, Lakshman's like, our father's gone nuts. And our father's, lost in lust and all of that. So let's just jail our father and you become king. And again, Ram is like, I am not king yet. The king has decided. It is done. So none of this is mine. This kingdom is not mine by inheritance. Whatever is not mine until it is given to me. And once it is given to me, then my life takes higher precedence. Like the country takes higher precedence. But until then, I am nothing. Right? So he's like, my father's word has to be kept because the people will look up to my father. And if the king doesn't keep his word, then nobody else will. You cannot hold anyone else accountable. So this is like one of those examples, right? And then when he tries to convince Sita not to come with him, she throws one rule book after another at him. And finally, he's like, okay, fine, you come with me. Right? Because he was the only one sent to exile. People think that three of them went to exile, but only he was sent. The other two decided to come with him and they won the argument on that. So she goes out of the palace and it's in full decor that she goes out of the palace with him. But she always wins every argument. Even the last, the ending part where the Agni Pariksha happens is an example of the same kind of a situation where Ram says the law of the land decides that a woman who's been with another man cannot be queen and cannot come back with him. So he is not bigger than the law of the land. There is no loss of love. This same Ram was crying at the loss of his wife before he rescued her. Once he rescues her, he becomes stone cold because he's like, I am king as soon as I go back. I cannot have a wife because then I cannot tell others not to. Because the law of the land states that I'm not the one modifying laws and putting laws and all of that. So it's very clear in the Valmiki Ramayana that the king is not making the laws. The laws are there and the king is not modifying the laws for his benefit. So when he tells Sita this is happening, Sita is like, fine, if you don't want me. And he tells her, you pick any of the great warriors here. You pick Lakshman, you pick Sugriv, you pick anyone, be anyone's wife. I cannot take you back. And when Sita says, you know what, if you don't want me, I will immolate myself. And this is not something that Ram suggests. This is something that she suggests. And she's basically found a loophole in the law. Because if the purity of fire clears her, then she's clear. Because as soon as she is out of the fire, and as far as the story is concerned, as soon as she's out of the fire, the mood changes. There is no more argument. There is no more she can't be my wife. Nothing. He's like, oh, okay, we're one big happy family. Let's go back. Right. So it's a loophole in the law that has just immediately been cleared out. So neither of them ever stand above the law.
Got it. I've never really looked at Ramayana as a legal.
Which is why I love the book. You ask me, I think this will be a 3-hour podcast on Ramayana. So we should segue.
Talking of it, there is so much, you know, to dwell on in what you said. But right. in the interest of putting the focus back on what we actually not even started discussing yet,
right.
Which is art of a certain kind. I'm not using the M word. I'm using art of stories of a certain kind. Right?
Right.
So you are growing up with all of this information, and this, I'm assuming, it's a continuous fascination for you. Even when you're working, creating Fast and the Furious, you know, this is where your mind is.
Right.
So tell us about what you're trying to do at Vanar Sena Studio.
So with Vanar Sena Studios, of course, through animation, because it's a medium that I love, we're trying to put these stories back on the focus. As stories. So we call them katha. We call them stories. We even had this little series called Mytho Katha, where we said what the West calls myth, we call katha. Right? And the focus of Vanar Sena purely at this point is to tell stories. And stories as is. No filtering. No, unlike filter copy, right? No filtering. As is what is written, or with reinterpretations. When it's a reinterpretation, we tell you it's a reinterpretation. When it's not a reinterpretation, we'll tell you where the story is coming from. If it's folk, it's folk. If it's from text, it's text. If it's from a version of the text, we'll tell you that. So that, I think one of the main focuses, because I felt bad, like when the country started moving towards, I think even in today, you know how it's like, right? You say something about these characters, or you write a book about them, or you put a film out of that, everyone goes nuts, right? But this didn't exist even 20 years ago, right? 20 years ago, you had a lot of authors rewriting, revisiting, reinterpreting, and no one said anything. People actually thought that was the true version, right? Or that was what the original version was. It's just today that things are getting a little out of hand. And for me, this is very sad. I'm like, just because you love something, don't hold on to it like you want to squeeze the life out of it, right? And you lose the essence of it. You lose this entire narrative of statescraft or philosophy or equality. You completely lose the narrative because you focus on just one side of it. So for us, the goal is to not be preachy, to not be philosophical, but just put the stories in front of you so that maybe you'll find what I found out the very same way I found it out, right? By reading the stories. Like, no one told me this is so crazy. I just went through so many different varieties that I'm like, wow, this is, now I have to sit and think. So we are hoping that you would do the same with just the number of stories we put in front of you. And we put variation. Like when we did during Ganesh Festival Chaturthi last year, we did 2 origin stories of Ganesh. Not one, right? The one is the popular one. And then we did another one. And then people are like, but which one is the real one? We are like, you figure, right? You figure what the essence of this story is. So that's what we want to do. This is the goal with Vanar Sena, to put out stories, to put out, and if possible, even reinterpretations. Our philosophy, our ideas of how we look at things come in the reinterpretations. Like if you, I don't know if you watched the Durga video that we did. Now the Durga video is a reinterpretation. So we felt that that narrative needed changing. And this is something that we emphasize on, that these stories are not about whether they're real or not. But if you track back on when they were written, they give you a vision of society at that point. They kind of reflect what society is thinking. Like from the Sita that stood up and argued with Rang to the Sita who didn't have a voice. You kind of see how society went, right? So which is why we also do the reinterpretation, so that you can also push an idea into society. You can also kind of throw out like, this could be a better world, you know? And that's the focus. Like it's not a, we'd love to make money out of it, but that is not where this started, right?
But before we go into the commercial aspect of it, sure. you mentioned that you know, these stories are not told very often. And for those of us who follow you on your various handles, especially on Instagram, which is as Vanar Sena Studios, I've been a huge fan and I've been consuming that content for a while now. So I know exactly what you mean when you say these stories are not being told. But for the uninitiated, it seems today, you know, if you ask someone, you know, do we tell enough stories about mythology? Sorry to use the word. But he's going to say, yes, there are multiple versions of Ramayana coming on television, multiple versions of Mahabharata coming, a lot of popular cinema has are actually reinterpretations of these stories, etc. Right. So, what actually is the gap that you saw? What are the stories that we are not telling?
There are some things that we talk about that we try to bring back some perspectives. Like some stories, of course. Like you said, there are many people doing certain kinds of stories. One, high quality art and animation does not exist in India. So this is something, it exists in the outsource space. It exists when you work for Rhythm and News or DreamWorks or Double Negative or any of these companies. But it does not exist in terms of content creation. Right? There are maybe one or two players out there in the entire country right now who can do some high quality art as studios.
Why is that?
We've never been trained for it. We've never been nurtured for it. We've always been an outsourced destination. We are a cheap Indian destination, right? It's like how a lot of production is going to China, for example. It's because they're cheap. It's not because there are difficulties in various aspects, but you're going to China because you're cheaper than US, right? You wouldn't get something manufactured in US. You would do it in China. People came to India for the same reason. It was not because we were amazing at what we did. They figured that they could train us to be better, but we were cheap. So we are almost at a tenth of the price of what you would pay. Like an expensive Indian product is still at a tenth of a price of what you would pay abroad. So this became great. Plus we're English speaking, so it's easy to communicate. Otherwise, all of that business would have gone into further down Southeast Asia. But we, I think, had the advantage of English at that point. So we've been nurtured for the last 20 years or so. And Indian industry is maybe as old as 30 years, but not older than that. We've only been nurtured to do outsource work. We've not been nurtured to tell stories, to do animation, to do high quality animation that the world will get up and look at. Of course, there are a lot of Chota Bheems and Bal Ganeshes and all these outside in India, but none hold up on international scrutiny. So if you're asking me what gap we are filling, the art and animation is the gap we are filling on a larger degree. To do these stories at a level that the international audience kind of wakes up and looks up, right? And they will only look up if it is a certain level of quality. When they look at that quality, they're going to see Indian stories. So it's kind of approaching it from that direction. We are not trying to tell you this is a great story, listen to it. We're going to first tell you this is great quality if you appreciate it. And when it's great quality and you enjoy the visuals, we're going to throw in the stories for you. So that's the difference, I would say, in what we're trying to do.
You know, as a pure consumer, right, who knows not much about any of the scriptures or also not so much about the craft of animation, the other gap that I see is also that we've picked probably the easiest stories to tell, right? And also the less vibrant stories to tell. Like the fact that you take a character like Bheem and the only thing we have created indigenously is Chota Bheem. That's a shame, right? Nothing against Chota Bheem. But, you know, from the parts you mentioned and from the parts that I'm familiar with, our stories are again, apologies for the word, our mythologies are filled with gray characters, right? There is a lot of gray in it. Almost nobody is black or white. And for a country which otherwise celebrates a Batman or a, you know, or a nine man sort of thing, it almost seems intuitive that had these stories been even told, even without the grandiose of high investment animation, even if they've been told in a very easily digestible format, I'm sure the audience would have lapped it up, isn't it? Is that something you feel as well?
Yeah, absolutely. Because that is exactly the project that we're working on right now. Where we are trying to make this. We went for one of the pitches last year and we went abroad and we went to Kids Screen. I partnered with the studio in Bangalore. And what we realized was they don't know much about India at all. But how would they consume it? They would consume it if it was made easy for them to understand. Right? Made easy for them to kind of absorb initially. Small bite chunks. So that's exactly what we're working on right now. Where we are talking about the stories with a blend of philosophy in a way that you can very quickly grab onto it, and it's only 3 minutes per video, right? And we're going to throw that content out bit by bit to see how they kind of respond to it. Because there is, like you said, there is so much that you can, it's about people. That's again why I call them stories. These are not about gods, and you've followed the page, so you are probably aware, right? We don't use gods, we don't use the word demons. We don't use the word like fantasy of any kind.
Yeah.
We say devas, asura, rakshasa. As it is written, these could be different cultures, these could be different tribes.
And more often, and it's just first name.
Correct. More often, it's first name. So we don't say Lord Surya. We say Surya, like he's my buddy, right? So it's about stories of people like you and me. And these stories will relate to anyone because these are all human problems. These are all problems of relationships, problems of infighting, problems of lust and greed. Anyone's going to relate to it if we can just package them down, you know, into something that's easily digestible. So definitely what you're saying is true. And that's exactly what we're trying. We're trying to push it to, again, Chota Bheem is to us younger audience. We don't cater to a younger audience. Our audience, TG, starts at 16. So we're looking at that audience to crack into, which again does not exist in India. Like there's no animated stuff being made for a 16 plus audience. So which is why we have a little bit of sex, violence, blood. Like 9 out of 10 times Instagram stops us from promoting our work because there's a splatter of blood in one of the panels, right? So, but that's the audience that we are targeting. And we definitely see that as another gap. So there are certain areas where I feel like, if you put it very bluntly, I want to watch and hear the stories I want to watch. That is what you find on Vanarsena.
Have you found a sweet spot in terms of platform? Right? Like I'm saying, I sometimes feel Instagram is ideal for the kind of work that you do. Right. Sometimes I feel it's also a little restrictive, right? And again, I don't know if a graphic novel is really a route that one... What is an ideal platform for this story?
I think the social media space is great. Graphic novel, we're actually coming up with a comic app soon because we have 50 plus comics. So we want to make it multilingual so that it goes out to a larger audience. So we're trying to do a comic app. But in terms of platform, I think right now the platform is not my challenge. I feel like my challenge is still what we're working on in terms of building a team. So we, like animation can be a one-man job, but then that one man will take years, right, to finish even like 10 minutes of it. So it has to be a more collaborative effort with a lot of artists with similar sensibilities who can build something. And we don't have that yet. So we're trying to work on that so that we can go on to YouTube and we can go on to multiple platforms with videos that we can actually showcase. Because once we have a couple of videos that is even 10 minutes long. Today is an OTT game, right? Everyone's playing that game. And there are so many OTT channels out there. Putting out that content will become much, much more easier. But I think creation of content is where we're actually stuck at, not even the platform challenges.
How far are we from a Netflix original or a movie, you know, which
movie couple of years. Movie, because even in the animation space, even to think of releasing a movie, that's 5 years in production, right? So if I start today and I say I have my entire team and I have all the artists I need, and I start the film today, that's still a 5-year window. So a movie takes much longer in animation. Like every DreamWorks Pixar movie, what you see today started 5 years ago. So that's a much longer arc. But right now what we're working on, so that's the current project we're working on, is hopefully by March or April, it should be done. And that's for the festival circuit. We're doing a series of these small little episodic pieces. Of course, if that bites, then... If somebody bites, then we definitely have like a Netflix or Amazon that can maybe look at it. But we don't know yet because very, very uncharted territory. I was actually talking to some VCs also about the same thing. Very uncharted territory. There's not been a first foot yet, right, by anyone. So we have to figure out where this goes.
What is the audience truth that you're not sure about yet? Right? Like, for example, I don't know if I can tell with confidence that... you know, the audience of 16 to 25 today is really going to wear these stories on, you know, on their sleeve, right? And take pride from that. How do you feel about the audience? What do you feel are the audience truth that you're not really sure of today?
No, I'm pretty sure. That's what I said. I'm pretty sure of how this will be received once I have the ability to kind of get it going, right? In terms of artists, because anyone is going to wear it on their sleeve if I make it cool. It's as simple as that. Right? They don't care. My 16 plus audience does not care about philosophy. It does not care about the tradition. It does not care about the culture. Like, I'm not blind to those things. Right? I completely understand. Like, I spend a lot of time with 20-year-olds. I spend a lot of time talking to them, seeing what they're doing and how their life is. They don't care about the tradition or culture or even, for that matter, patriotism or any of that stuff. right? All they care about is cool factor. Is this cool enough to talk about? If it's cool enough to talk about, if it's funny enough to talk about, and funny is not a zone I'm going into. If funny was a zone I was going into, I think it would have been much easier. But funny, unfortunately for me, is not a zone I'm going into. So then I have to go with cool. Like I have to do, it has to be in like an Avengers or a Thor or a Hulk, or and there's grandeur to it and there's coolness, like a legend of the Legend of Korra or your Avatar, The Last Airbender, if you've seen those shows. Yeah. Very cool, right? Very, very cool visuals, graphics, choreography.
Yeah.
If we succeed in going down that zone, which of course comes with quality. That's the reason no one in India has created an Avatar, Airbender or a Korra, right? We have to first build that quality, which itself is a massive challenge. And if we build that quality level and if we manage to push in that direction, I have no doubt on the audience at that point.
What's the gold standard in this, right? Would you probably say the way Japan has done it?
Yes.
Is that the gold standard? Where do you pitch it?
For me, the gold standard is a mix. I love what Japan does and I love what Disney does. I love what some of the European companies are doing today. Like I love what Cartoon Saloon does. I love what Aardman has been doing for all these years. And Japan, of course, has been kind of setting the standard on a lot of the anime stuff that they've been doing. It is theirs after all. But that's the one thing I'm very realistic about. All these places took decades. It's not a short game. It's not going to happen tomorrow if I decide it has to. Right? So I'm here for the long game. I'm here to kind of see how slowly and surely we can push. But exactly. That's the gold standard. Like India has not seen anything like that till now. The world has not seen anything from India like that till now in terms of original content. So that's definitely where I'm heading. Like for me, I love Disney and I love Japanese anime. And these are the spaces I want to go. What is our style? We'll find out, right? As today, I have a certain style and my artists have different styles, which you see in the comics, where we see different kinds of artwork sometimes. I think when we come together as a team, we'll find out what that style is.
Right. And, I stopped you earlier when you were talking about revenue models and commercial aspects of it, right? Until the point, of course, you have a film on the floor or a Netflix original on the floor. What are the different revenue models that you are currently dabbling with, right? For something like that. And what is working for you?
Right now, there's no revenue model, honestly, right? I'll try and answer this maybe differently, indirectly. When we started off, I was on my savings. Then when people saw the kind of work I do, I started getting a little commercial offers here and there, do some ads, do some commercials, do some snippets. Then I figured out that doing ads and commercials and snippets, and I have no time for Vanarse now. So the first year I did one video, right? And then a few little GIFs and stuff, but zero content as such. So I put up a name of Vanarsena, but there was no work happening. Then a couple of VCs also asked me if I want to build it into a company, but they're like, okay, you do it like this, like this, like this. Don't do Indian stories because very controversial. I'm like, you're taking the heart out of this. So that's not going to happen. Then I think I kind of took a break again on savings. And then we went on and started doing some comics. I started opening up for training. So today, we do maybe 2 or 3 commercial projects a year. We struggle. Last year, we actually got this amazing people called Zebu Animations who decided to fund us, no questions asked, in terms of at least one project. Like, they were not that cash heavy to say, we'll just fund your company. But they said, at least on a certain project, here is the money, do what you think is best. And that was the best thing that could have happened. I think me sticking to my guns probably helped at that point. And so we've been working on that project. So there's a little bit of revenue that comes in every month. We have volunteers on board. So none of them get paid unless they do a project with us. But they learn. So last year, August, I think we pivoted very quickly to COVID was happening. Everyone stuck at home. So we like, you know what? We'll train you in art and animation. We announced that in August. I have 100 trainees now. And all of them just want to learn. And they're all kind of, I think, feeding off the same energy because they're just waiting to jump on to a project. That's their incentive. So the training is entirely free. There's no cost. We don't charge anything. We just want to see the entire ecosystem grow. So for me, from day one with Vanarsena, the goal was Indian animation, Indian stories, done by Indians and spread out into the rest of the world, right? As a big, these are my basic three criterias. And when I say Indian stories, I mean even the Cholas and the Cheras and the and Ashoka and Indian national movement, all of them come in Indian stories. So we'll talk about India, which is why I am Senapati. So when I go for a conference or when I go for any kind of a talk, even abroad, they're like, oh, Vanarsena Studios, Senapati. No one understands what both words are.
That's your official title.
That's official title. Senapati or Vanarsena Studios. Never, I insist that they stick to it. They're like, can we call you founder, CEO? I'm like, no. Senapati, Vanarsena Studios. So then it encourages another conversation of what is Senapati? What is Vanarsena Studios? I'm like, come, let me talk to you about India. Right? So we kind of make sure that happens. Now, coming back to your revenue model question, there's this little bit of support from Zeebu. And there's some projects in terms of commercials that we do. If you ask me whether there's a revenue model, I'm constantly experimenting. Right now, we're going to try the app. We're going to try some YouTube videos. We're going to see how we can build in sustainable revenue while we continue doing what we want to do. I'm not looking at a massive jump because I know a massive jump will happen. One or two Netflix or Amazon shows, and I know a massive jump will happen. But we're skillfully not ready today. We might be in 6 months, which is why even when, and it's also 16 plus animation, never before done in India. So even when VCs talk to me about it, they're like, okay, we're interested in talking to you. You ask me for a projection, I don't know. You ask me, where will this go in 5 years? I don't know. Are you willing to risk it with me? Sure. Amazing, right? And I will keep doing what I'm doing. Like, I've been doing it for 3 years without any money. I'm going to continue doing it. But will this be bought by Disney? Will this be bought by Netflix? Will the content sell? I have zero idea. So I started at zero followers. I'm 60,000 followers today, and it's great. It's working. So I'm clearly probably doing something right.
Right.
But you ask me about revenue models, projections, I'm the worst person to talk to about this.
I think, you know, interestingly, we just did a project together, you know, for a yes. brand called Natural Diamonds Council. We did a lot of illustrations together for that, right? And it was fascinating, you know, to do that. And, you know, to me, you know, every time I see the content, you know, that you put out on Instagram, etc., I'm like thinking myself, this is so good that this should not be free. This is no chance that this is actually free.
Right.
So it's from that perspective, I'm very, very positive about the app that you're building, right? I genuinely feel
awesome.
It's going to be phenomenal. I'm sure people will
and the app also, we're going to start with it's going to be a free app with maybe ads and stuff that we can kind of utilize, because a lot of people wrote to us from especially tier 2 and tier 3 saying that my parents can't read English, or how do I explain this to my non-English speaking aunt or my grandmom, but they would like to read it, or they would like to read it out to one of their nephews or nieces or someone. So which is why we thought, okay, let's do an app that is multilingual, but that's going to be free again. We're going to see if we can monetize that through ads and things like that.
But I'm also, you know, very excited about what you said. It is not just about ancient, you know, characters in the Vedas, etc., but this country is so full of stories. You know, you go down to, like you said, the South Indian rulers. There are so many stories about South Indian rulers that most of India doesn't really know.
Correct.
Right? And there's so many stories on the freedom struggle itself that people right. don't know. So I'm very excited about that. You know, before we close, Vivek, what are some of your most favorite stories from India? Beyond the obvious, you know, beyond the Ramayana, etc. Who are some of your most favorite characters, and what are some of your most favorite stories?
That's a super, super tough question, because my favorite story is Ramayana, but my favorite character is Krishna. Mm. And I love the Mahabharata for its spectrum that it has. And especially the Mahabharata, it's one of those scenarios where you sit back and smile, because I feel like everyone's got the Mahabharata wrong. Right? Like the ones who've not read it. The ones who've read it, understand it. But the ones who've not read it and have gone through popular retellings, everyone's got the Mahabharata wrong, because their idea of good versus bad and dharma versus adharma and all that is nonsense. Because the Mahabharata, like you mentioned earlier, the Mahabharata is as gray as it can get. Like it's insanely gray. it's largely a dispute between one Thakur family kind of situation where the rest of the country started singing about it, right? But everyone had a stake in the game. No one was doing it for right. Everyone was doing it. It is a property dispute, right? It happens in your family, my family, everyone else's family. When finally it comes to property, everyone's fighting. And the Mahabharata is just that, right? It's just another property dispute. So it's hard for me to pick a favorite story. Like, there are fascinating incidents in all of these. Like, the Mahabharata is a collection of short stories. The Mahabharata itself could be another Vanar Sena, right? Because it's another collection of short stories. So there's so many stories there. And then there is the... I'm honestly not fond of the ones that are devotional. Like the Tulsi Ramayana. I'm not a fan. It's hardcore devotional. Where Ram went in smiling doing this to Ravan, right? So it's... I'm not a fan of those, if you ask me. But I'm a fan of the what the ancients wrote in terms of those stories. And then, of course, there's history or the other stories that are more recent. Like, we recently did this. We're on Discord, all our volunteers, and we try to change our names every week to something that is some kind of a world around it. Like, you can pick up Marvel or DC or whatever, and then each person becomes one character from that. So that you read up, and if I ask you if you're Spider-Man, then I ask you, hey, what happened to Spider-Man? You'll have to tell me what happened, right? So we do a little bit of research and stuff. So one of the things we did for 1 week was Kings of India. So there were some fascinating names and some fascinating stories where everyone picked up one king from somewhere in Coorg and from Mangalore and from Orissa, Kalinga, like all kinds of historical characters popped up. And there's so much there. I find it very hard to pick a favorite. Like, it's just so much fascination.
Okay, let me ask a different question, same family. Okay. And, you know, usually we end the episode by asking our guest, you know, what he or she is watching or reading or listening to these days. I would love to hear, you know, where you're spending your time as well. But also, what is your most favorite animation series / cinema?
Oh man, it's another super tough question. Huge fan. I can't do favorites. I'm horrible at this game. I love Disney.
Like, for example, you know, for the longest time, I was fascinated by Toy Story, right? It's just that the first of that, it was just something else. I never seen something like that. And when I saw it, I saw it for the first time in Dolby. If you remember back in India, that's when Dolby also launched, close to that. And it was fabulous. And then, of course, you know, over a period of time, that always remained the most favorite animation, you know, more for the writing as well as for the craft of it. And then Wall-E happened. Right.
Oh yeah. Oh man, Wall-E.
Wall-E was just Wall-E was something else for me. Right? That film spoke to me like no other film did. The first half of the film, right? I don't so much care for the second half, the spaceship, and everything else that happened in the second half. Right? But the first half just really, really spoke to me. So do you have anything like that which you would
Yeah, absolutely. I can watch Beauty and the Beast and Tarzan over and over and over for the joy of animation. For how well done the animation is. Right. It's beautiful. I can watch Incredibles. For how well, like, Marvel should take a page out of Incredibles. Yeah. How can you make a superhero story a family story? Right? How can you, it's a superhero film where everyone's in capes and everyone's in masks, but the story is about a family.
Yeah.
It's about the conflict within that family, and it's beautiful. And similarly, if you go to like Japan, I love Death Note. Have you watched Death Note?
No, I have not.
So like that blew my mind because it's animated. It's Japanese anime, not a single action sequence. Right? Wow. It's a thriller. It's a thriller and keeps you at the edge of your seat. Beautifully done. Death Note. You should check that out. Then there's stuff like Attack on Titan, which is again Japanese, which is mad animation, goes nuts. I also love Miyazaki's films, Ghibli's films.
Oh, yes.
So there's like Mononoke. Recently, someone saw Mononoke and he's like, I don't know, I didn't understand the film. And then I kind of tried to explain what I understood in terms of subtext of the film and how the film has like multiple layers on layers of subtext of it. Like someone is like, oh, I don't understand that guy, the hero is running, sometimes saving the girl, running, sometimes saving the other people on the other side, the guys are attacking the city. And I'm like, exactly, that's you and me conflicted between nature and, you know, civilization. You know, we are also running back and forth trying to figure which side to pick half the time. So I love Miyazaki stuff. Yeah. And if it's live action, I kind of go nuts every time someone mentions The Matrix. right. Like in terms of like The Matrix, I remember The Matrix blew my mind, especially when I was starting my career. I was fiddling around with my little software and processes, and suddenly Matrix happened on screen, and I think I went numb for like a week. I was like, what did I just watch? It was everything. It was philosophy, technology, animation, VFX. It was just nuts, right? Everything thrown into one package. Yeah. So some hardcore life philosophies in The Matrix. So yeah, I think The Matrix blew my mind. So there's so many of them. Like for me, it's very hard to pick.
Right. Extraordinary. Great. Vivek, thank you so much. We've been speaking for an hour, but I know I couldn't have told. Thank you so much. I really, really look forward to what's coming out next as part of Vanar Sena. Where can people catch Vanar Sena? Is Vanar Sena Studios on Instagram? Where else can they catch?
Vanar Sena Studios on Instagram, Vanar Sena Studios on YouTube, which we are not completely, like we're not very active, but we will be soon. The artists are coming up and they should be doing some great work soon. VanarSenaStudios.com is our website where we'll have updates. Where, okay, also announcement, Vanar Sena School is coming up. So we're going to have again Instagram, YouTube, all of that for Vanar Sena School. So there's all of that. That's
where people can learn art and animation.
We're going to set up, there are of course a million YouTube videos online for art and animation. We're going to set up curriculums if you are looking for a job. So if you want a job for a certain kind of role in a certain studio, watch these set of videos or watch these set of videos, and that's a curriculum. So you don't have to worry about a graduation, any of that. You hone that skill, you will get a job.
Fascinating.
Stuff like that.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Superb. Good luck to all of these, and speak to you soon.
Thank you.
Cheers. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
If you like this podcast, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can listen to us on the IVM podcast app or ivmpodcasts.com. You can also follow us on our social media. We are at IVM podcasts on Twitter and Instagram. And if you want to reach out to me, I am the_Karthik. That's Karthik with an H on Twitter, and filter_coffee. That's coffee with a K on Instagram.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank our sponsors very quickly this week, thewholetruthfoods.com, Storytel, and Seat. We really do appreciate your support. And we had a great week on the network this week. So tune in for some sweetness with our hosts Sadaf and Archit as they hone their sweet tooth and talk about candies. The famous, the healthy, the traditional, and international. Check out Naan Curry. You'll enjoy it. On last week's episode of The Note, Maruk and I spoke to TV presenter and columnist Veer Sanghvi, who analyzed the 2 years of the second term of the Modi government. As China and India signed the disengagement agreement along the LAC, Lieutenant General Dr. Prakash Menon and Manoj Kewalramani joined Suyash Desai to discuss the process and the consequences it will have on the nation and in world politics. Dr. Anton Harder joins Hamsini Hariharan on States of Anarchy to discuss India's right to a seat at the United States Security Council. Ashton Doctor talks about duty, how individually it binds us, and how as a society it is liberating. Check out The Habit Coach with Ashton every day. Great show and great fun to listen to that. On Football Shootwall, the boys talk about their loves and sorrows for teams and their current ranks in the world of football. And also do remember to check out Cyrus Says. We had a great week last week. We had Amol Mazumdar, the ex-cricketer. We had Rocky and Mayur. And we did the Valentine special with Aisha and Kunal. Great fun. Do check it out. I'm sure you will enjoy that. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Namaskar, dear friends. My name is Ashish Vidyarthi. Life, as you know, is a journey. And you and I, travelers, how can we celebrate this travel? I have a podcast for you. Begin the Journey. I share stories and moments from my life. Do tune in every Monday and Thursday to listen to my podcast on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcast from. pictures